Kevin, I'm Alex.
I'm Geordie. This is episode 2.
Indeed, it is episode 2. My God, we've already gotten to the second episode. I never thought we'd make it past the pilot.
No, me neither. I was hoping we wouldn't.
Your voice sounds fine. And when I say fine, I mean it sounds like a castrated 12-year-old, but you know.
Oh, does it? We can start a poll on that down below.
Viewers, tell us below. Who do you think below? Yeah, presumably it will be below. Viewers, tell us below.
No, it's above. YouTube changed the formatting just for you.
Yeah, viewers, tell us who you think has the more manly voice. I'm guessing it's me. Again, I'm really... I mean, we should probably say what this is about first. Yeah, so viewers...
No. This is in the dark. You know, it's a little challenge. If you can guess it within 5 minutes, what the fuck we're talking about, you can be our
The
therapist.
Giant power armor versions of us on the front cover might give it away. We are, as is pretty obvious, I think, talking about Fallout and...
What? Fuck.
I know. I'm sorry. I know you wanted to talk about the Moscow Ballet, but we insisted we had to get through Fallout.
I thought this was the Barbie episode. I might have to tap out for this one. You can talk on your own for a bit.
Oh my goodness, I'm really intrigued actually, just based on like the way we look on the front cover, who they're going to think whose voice belongs to.
Yeah, that's true.
Because they don't know which of us is which, they just know that one of us looks like that and one of us looks like the other person.
How long can we keep this going before they give it away?
Yeah, we'll just sadly add more people to, like, to the front cover so they just don't know who it is, like random celebrities from the 1930s, like Lillian Russell.
Yeah, in 3 months' time I'm going to get facial reconstruction surgery, just really throw the cat amongst the pigeons.
Yeah, just like full-on Fallout 4 style synth retention, just like get your face changed.
That sounds like something a synth would say.
Sounds like something a fake person would say. I love it. Oh, we'll get onto that in a second when we talk about Fallout 4. I mean, I think the first thing to talk about is just what Fallout was to you. Like, what was your first experience of Fallout? When did you get into the series? Because I know you and I are huge Fallout fans.
Yeah, and I think we shared the same opening moment to Fallout as well, which is walking out of the vault in DC in Fallout 3.
Yeah, that was my first experience. Actually, no, I tell a slight lie. My first memory of Fallout is, do you remember the trailer they had for Fallout 3 when they were selling it? The I Don't Want to Set the World on Fire coming
just
out.
Just panning out of the radio.
Out of the bus, yeah.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, we'll get onto this again when we talk about the Fallout TV series possibilities. Like, that's a brilliant cold opening for a TV show. Like, kudos to them for doing that in a video game, but like, my God, that would be incredible.
Well, that escalated quickly. Nice catchy tune from the past? No.
Yeah, it's like, wow, this is a really nice tune. I wonder if what this game is about. Oh my God. Oh, well, DC's looked better. I mean, not a whole lot better, but it looked vaguely better.
Yeah, did it.
It's the secret truth. Like, if Fallout isn't actually an alternate universe, it's just what the world's going to look like after the second Trump presidency.
Exactly. Thanks to Trump now, they don't have to spend anything on the set.
On the CGI budget for if we do a TV show there.
Aw, see, he's all heart, really.
Yeah, he's the guy in the power armor at the beginning. Yeah. Just looking contrite as he stares at the camera. Just like
a very,
oh,
very
shucks.
Clever PR bloke.
Oh, goodness. Anyway, yeah, so Fallout 3 was our first experience. What was your, like, because I didn't know Liam Neeson was voicing a character in the game until like the opening 3 minutes when he speaks to you. I just remember the incredibly, his delivery gets better in fairness to him, that very bad video game actor sort of delivery. I was just like, it's a boy.
Is it?
Is it? My God.
Well, my favourite is, obviously, if you choose, whatever you choose your character to look like.
James will look like the same.
Yeah, James will look the same. So if you choose your guy to be a black guy, Liam Neeson is now a black guy, and that's one of my favourite things in the game.
I mean, that's a marriage made in heaven. Like, in an ideal universe, Liam Neeson is a black guy.
Oh, yeah.
Because Liam Neeson is too badass to be a white guy.
Exactly. Like, it's little known truth.
We white guys are just not cool enough to pull off the level of badassery that Liam Neeson aspires to.
Liam Neeson, the secret brother.
Oh my God, can you imagine an action movie with him and Samuel L. Jackson? I would watch the shit out of that. Oh,
so many motherfuckers followed by disappointed tips on swearing.
Yeah, like the new Die Hard will just be like John McClane running away from Liam Neeson and Samuel L. Jackson. I don't care that Samuel L. Jackson's already been in one. He's coming back.
Yeah, he needs to.
He'll be pissed off this time. Well, he was pretty pissed off the first time round. He'll be even more pissed off this time.
I think that's just his character in every film, isn't it? That pissed off guy.
Can I ask a question? Because obviously the character creation about Fallout, with Fallout, it's very similar to the one in Skyrim and a lot of games that Bethesda does. Have you ever played as an opposite gender character to yourself? I mean, like, have you ever played as a girl
in Skyrim? Yes. In Fallout, no,
because I never have, and I don't know whether that's just my knee-jerk thing of like, I want my character to be me,
you know. Well, I suppose Skyrim's more fantasy based, so there's less. I mean, we're talking about realistic, you know. Fallout is more realistic, obviously. It can happen totally. I swear, please.
In the universe where we never invented the micro transistor, I think that's the official explanation, isn't it, for why
the transceiver. transceiver. I believe it's the transceiver. They just said this little box, this little piece of serious equipment didn't get invented, so everything's giant.
Like that, and I need to catch up. I should probably have done more research for the podcast.
I'm sure it's the transceiver because I remember watching the same.
Because the divergence point is literally just after World War II, isn't it? Because Roosevelt reforms everything into 13 Commonwealths rather than 50 states.
Yeah,
and that's the thing that kicks it all off. And then they don't invent the micro. Is it the transistor or the transceiver? The micro something.
I feel like we need to have a pause to Google this at some point.
The piece of kit that allows us to miniaturize electronics basically doesn't get invented. They have to stick with like those gigantic, amazing sort of glass diodes. That you find all over Fallout 4 for scrap.
So basically, if Tesla were alive, he would be making a shitload of Fallout.
Yeah, literally.
Especially in the DLCs.
I think that's the divergence point anyway. Like, and obviously, like, you just sort of spirals from there. Like, there's no EU, there's a European Commonwealth instead, and stuff like that.
I think we'll have to put "I think" in front of everything, because we should probably make it clear that we don't know what the fuck we're talking about.
I know, for example, that obviously the Cold War was between China and America, not between Russia and America, and in the Fallout universe, Russia and America have a fairly alright relationship. Like, they have consulates. At the very least, they've got consulates, I think it's mentioned in Fallout 3.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, they go back to it a little bit with Operation Anchorage.
Yeah, they do. Well, I mean, Anchorage is obviously like a very biased simulation that was created by General...
The Yanks.
Yeah, General Chase to like self-aggrandize himself. And like, don't the notes you find in the Outcast bunker sort of from the people who built the Anchorage simulation sort of say that it was just a bunch of crap, that none of this happened. Like the way it's told, they didn't have the VTOL vertibirds by that point. They didn't have the Chimera tanks in the real Anchorage. They didn't have power armor by that point,
Fantastic excuse to steal a fat man that doesn't deteriorate, though.
That is absolutely true.
The glitches in that were...
If only General Constantine Chase's coat hadn't been glitched.
Every console game was just...
We're going to have a discussion about your glitches in a little bit. Don't worry, it's coming.
Well, I mean, you could follow the Star Wars Battlefront thing and had it as a... optional extra into Fallout 4. It could be a loot chest. Why not? That works.
Yeah, we all love it. As anyone who listened to the last podcast knows, we love our loot
chests.
We're
still bitter.
We still love our loot chests.
We've done nothing but sit here and seethe for 2 weeks.
I mean, like, things like... I'm presuming after Fallout 3, your next one would have been Fallout New Vegas, because that was the pretty
start. Well, yeah, but it took me a while to get into it. I played it... When it came out, I played it for a couple hours and thought...
It's a very
Fallout
tonally,
3 is better.
It's a massive tonal shift. Actually, this is the thing that's happened since Fallout 3, is that the tone of the games has shifted, not a lot, but it's shifted enough to be noticeable.
Mm.
I'm not complaining about that. I love the wacky tone that started up in New Vegas more than I did in Fallout 3, and I like that it carried on into Fallout 4. Although, actually, Fallout 4 tries
to create a mix of both.
Yeah, and fails. And it doesn't really commit to either, and the end result is it comes off looking a bit awkward.
Well, yeah, it's always, if you try to commit to try to not commit and go for two things, you're always going to be hit and miss for most people.
Yeah. And again, like, the story, and this will be the focus of our discussion, really, because we are a storytelling channel, don't you know?
There once was a little boy called Jim. I can't think of anything.
He gave birth to a kid in a vault, and all went to crap from there. Well, he didn't give birth, his wife gave birth, but you know what I'm talking about.
Glad to know I'm not the only one that sucks at rhymes.
But yeah, the story in Fallout 3 was a lot more interesting, I think, than the story in New Vegas, and actually much more so than Fallout 4.
Very cinematic in Fallout 3 almost as well. It's something you could imagine watching.
Yeah, absolutely. Whereas, like, Fallout New Vegas, I love the introduction of factions. I love proper factions. I know we had the Enclave and Brotherhood in
But you couldn't even join the Enclave. You could just over the Brotherhood.
Yeah, you could
slightly.
Sort of join the Enclave. But the Enclave would sort of shoot at you. You just end up doing what Eden wanted.
It's not really much of an alliance.
Yeah, it isn't really. You don't get much out of it. And Fallout 4 tried to rescue that situation even more by properly introducing factions, which I really like, actually. It's one of the really good things about Fallout 4 is the factions.
Hmm.
Especially, and it is a very Fallout Bethesda thing, the fact that they're all dicks in their own way. There isn't really, like, a good side.
Yeah.
Even the Minutemen, who are meant to be, like, the best one, have Preston fucking Garvey. Which is enough
Goody
of a...
Goody McFucking Two-Shoes. Yeah,
which is enough of a negative for me just to want to, like, butcher all the Minutemen off the bat.
I still
want to
handshake the guy who runs around Comic-Con handing out quest markers.
I heard of another settlement. Need your help. Oh my god, Preston, not now.
So, son, what do you do for a living? Nothing. Nothing at all. I hand out flyers. Why do you wear a cowboy hat? Reasons.
Just like you have the mysterious stranger like sting every time like you appear, like doo 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 doo.
I need a sound box that just plays that every time I walk into a room.
I'm gonna make that my text alert noise. actually, like, while we're talking about that, I want to have a spare little moment for the music of Fallout. Again, like speaking of someone who obviously primarily acts in film, theatre, and TV, like they have done such a good job at making that world come to life with the obviously by bringing back the 1950s kind of like musical. Songs and stuff from like Bette Davis and Billie Holiday and all those blokes, and also like there's the main theme. I don't know who composed the main theme actually, but like the one that starts off in Fallout 3 with a very like heavy, clunky version.
I believe it's called something like The Crows Come Home or something like that.
But I can't remember who actually wrote it.
Man, we've got to do some research in the ad break here.
And then Vegas...
the self-promotion ad break, of course.
And then Vegas had the sort of like more like westernized, stingy version of it.
Yeah.
And then Fallout 4 has its own sort of like more upbeat, quiet piano version of it.
Well, it's almost like it's trying to reminisce on itself.
Yeah, especially it feels nostalgic.
The scene where you leave the vault in Fallout 4, it's almost like it's screaming just like, hey, remember when you did this in Fallout 3?
And it was better.
Yeah, we're sorry.
I'm still like, you know what I'm really intrigued by, and it's my burning question from all the Fallout games. It's so petty, but where the hell does Dogmeat come from? Because he's in every game, and they're set 30 years apart in some cases, and he's always the same.
The only one where he's got a bit of background is Fallout 3, where you find him in the scrapyard with his dead owner.
Yeah, yeah.
That's his background, and that's it.
And there was a fan theory for a while before it was disproved that the dead owner was not the Chosen One, but the... no, the Chosen One. Is that the Chosen One is the vault dweller's kid? Or grandkid? Fallout 2 is main protagonist.
Must be.
The one who started up like Arroyo, which becomes the capital of NTR later on.
It must be, yeah.
Shady Sands, rather. He found Shady Sands.
Well, hang on. You say Dogmeat was in all three. He wasn't in Fallout New Vegas, was he? That was Rex.
Yeah, Rex, dog, Rex replaced him in...
Fallout, obviously Dogmeat's replacement, but...
Yeah, but like Fallout 4 is like set, you know, a decade after Fallout 3, and Dogmeat's still apparently alive and well and young.
Well, yeah.
And on the other side of the country.
We got the puppies perk. That was the best thing about DLCs, man. Dogmeat could get shot in the face over and over again.
And you still have more Dogmeat.
Just more puppies to shoot.
Oh, Dogmeat, my favourite video game dog ever.
Kill Dogmeat, steal his Dogmeat, eat his Dogmeat.
You do not kill Dogmeat. You do not touch Dogmeat. No, Dogmeat, no.
Do you want to put your erection away?
What, for Dogmeat? Oh, never. Yeah. I will die with Dogmeat. Dogmeat is my friend. I love Dogmeat.
Do you want me to give you a moment?
With Dogmeat. I want all the moments with Dogmeat.
Oh, God.
Dogmeat will be at my wedding.
I feel we're descending here.
He'll be officiating at my wedding.
Oh, gosh. Can you skip my invite for that? That's not something I want to witness, ever.
And then, like, you just purchased Fallout 4, you traitor.
Yes.
Several years too late.
Well, everyone was doing it. I shied away from it, and it was too popular then.
Yeah, I got it when it first came out, and I've bought all the DLCs. I mean, I bought all the DLCs for all of them, and we can get into talking about the DLCs in a bit. But Fallout 4 for me, whilst a superior game from a gameplay standpoint, is is a noticeably inferior story and a noticeably inferior main character, which is weird because he speaks, whereas Lone Wanderer never spoke, but was somehow more enigmatic for that.
Mm. Well, you know, if you had Fallout 3 with all the gizmos and things like that Fallout 4 has, Fallout 4 wouldn't hold a candle to it.
Yeah, if Fallout 3 had the graphical upgrades and the better engine that Fallout 4 has, then it would be...
The improved combat system.
That must be on the horizon. They must be doing not a reboot, when we're talking about, like, the updated version, the... What's the word for it, like, when they brought out the...
The remaster.
Remaster, thank you.
Well, Bethesda are a bit weird with that, because I remember when they did the Skyrim remaster...
Yeah.
They're not a big fan of doing it on their old games, and they literally were quoted to say,
we could have done it with remastered about a billion times now.
Yeah, because they can still make money off it. But they said, yeah, we could have done it with Oblivion, which everyone was screaming for them to do, but it would have been hard.
Yeah, but the thing with Fallout 3 is that like there is some evidence that they are actually planning on doing this, because they thought, like, originally it was banned in Germany, the game. Because Germany, obviously, is a country that shies away from any excessive violence, particularly anything that's got even vague World War II pure master race themes, and obviously the Enclave hit that hammer pretty hard.
Why? They had nothing to do with World War II.
And so, like, it was banned in Germany, and years down the line, I think it was this year, Bethesda overturned a court order that finally allowed it to be played in Germany. And, like, you're thinking, like, well, what's the point? Why bother
yeah.
if you're if if you're not going to be doing a remaster, because it's too late now to sell Fallout 3, really, to Germany, unless
they
just...
Unless they think that there's so much hype built up around
it. Yeah, or unless they just have such a point of pride that they just felt like the need to just, you know...
We need to win this.
Win it anyway. But, like, there is some evidence. Also, because Fallout 3, I think, is the most fondly remembered of the ones that have... Since, I mean, the new era of Fallout, you know, past Fallout Brotherhood.
Well, there's evidence. There's quite a lot of modders doing it themselves as well. You look on YouTube, you can see quite a few... Yeah. You know, Fallout 3 and a Fallout 4 engine. And when they actually get things up and running, I think someone just built Rivet City.
Yeah.
In a Fallout 4 engine. It's actually pretty decent. So if Bethesda don't do it, eventually we'll get a mod that kind of lives up to it. But obviously we want the polished version.
Yeah.
Have to get Liam Neeson back. Do some more.
And it's interesting as well, because actually, again, the DLCs, the storytelling sort of collapse that happened with Fallout 4. It's a bit unfair to call it a collapse. I'm being over dramatic for the state, for, you know, for a fact.
Bit of an anticlimax.
Yeah, just not as good. But like that theme ran with the DLC as well. Because in Fallout 3, obviously you had Broken Steel.
Yep.
Which, to be fair, was more of a fix for everyone getting pissed off that you couldn't carry on playing the game once you finished it.
And then they went and made the same mistake for New Vegas anyway.
Yeah.
Well, they said that they put too much effort into the ending conclusions for like each NPC. That they just didn't want you to play afterwards, which made little to no sense anyway.
Yeah, for an open world game.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, you know, they didn't learn from this. They learned from the mistakes of Fallout 4. That isn't the case in Fallout 4.
Yeah.
Annoying, but but the ending of each storyline is so unsatisfying that you're still pissed off anyway.
Yeah, so you just go and shoot some people.
Yeah, exactly. But at least you can take out your rage with some passing raiders who've probably very surprised at the level of your anger.
What have we done? We've angered the gods.
Just like a bunch of mini nukes fall out of the sky and they're like, but we weren't doing anything to you.
I was just taking a poop.
Like, we were on our way to kill the gunners. You don't like those guys, do you?
I like them more than you.
I like them more than the Minutemen. Fuck it out.
Bomb the Minutemen.
I'd love the Minutemen if there was the choice to like make Preston Garvey your bitch, but like Preston Garvey is just an annoyance.
Well,
that
that's
never
your
needs.
Kink, not mine.
Well, but doesn't like Preston Garvey is effective. Like, he goes like, you're the general of the Minutemen, but I'm still running things,
and I'm still telling you what to do.
And I'm telling you what to do. And you're like, well, I'm not really in charge, then, am I? Screw you.
Which is why a bullet to the face works better.
Yeah, which is actually why when the Nuka World DLC came out and you could all around the Raiders, that was much more satisfying, because like you could immediately just overturn the Minutemen and just be like, Raiders run the place now. Screw you. Yes, I was an evil character. You probably could guess that.
Really?
I was the calm and negative character.
I couldn't be an evil character, especially not in Fallout 3. The main reason being, you couldn't hear Liam Neeson be disappointed at you.
Yeah.
Especially, it's such a pathetic way of being disappointed when you blow up Megaton and he's just like, I can't believe you've done this.
It is the big
moral... I'm so disappointed.
It is the big moral question. Did you blow up Megaton?
Well, I've had multiple playthroughs. I've probably blown it up more times than I've spared
it. Okay, first time you played it through, did you blow it up or did you save it?
Saved it.
Okay, I blew it up the first time I played.
You know, that doesn't surprise me.
I really wanted that suite in Tenpenny Tower.
I know.
It was mint. I loved it.
To be fair, the first time I played it, I was an absolute Fallout virgin, and I played all the main quest line, got through it in about a day, and thought, oh, this game's shit, because I didn't have Broken Steel, so I couldn't play after that, and it was just like, oh, the end. And I was like, okay. That was like 6 hours of gameplay. Cheers.
Did you just not do any side quests?
No, because I didn't realise it was a thing, because that was my first experience with those kind of games. The rest of it was all arcade shite, so I thought, no, let's just follow this. Then I went back and replayed it and had to change my underpants quite a few times.
It's a great game.
It is.
But yeah, like, the DLC got noticeably worse. Like, obviously, Broken Steel was a good bit of DLC for fixing the problems that they introduced in the first place. Like, I love how nonsensical it was as well before that fix. Like, if you had Forks or... Sergeant or like
Sharon,
yeah, like as your companion, the radiation immune dudes, and like you're like, someone needs to go into this radiation chamber to save everyone. It's
off
gonna
you
be
go,
fatal.
Forks.
And Forks is like, you're like, Forks, you'll do this, and Forks goes like, ah, I'm sorry, but it's your destiny. I can't take it from you, and you're like, what the fuck?
Well, the thing is, you still get shit for that in the credit scene that they keep in. It even gives you shit and says, you know, the
he tries to duck his responsibilities. Like, yeah, screw you, dude.
He didn't follow the father's selfless example. Well, he wasn't going to die.
Also,
what was I going to do?
Also, yeah, the dad's selfless example. The difference is the dad couldn't escape at that point.
Yeah.
Like, it was sacrifice himself and allow the son to get away, or don't.
Or kill everyone.
Yeah, like, so, I mean, it's not really the same situation, Ron Perlman.
Looking at you, Hellboy. Just kidding,
I do
love
miss,
you.
I do miss his voice for Fallout 4.
Oh.
I do miss that intro. Any TV series...
I think Fallout 5 definitely needs to have him as a character.
Oh God, yeah. That would actually be a great way of tying it up, to have a character called the Storyteller, and have
just
him be
the wanders the wastes.
Because I think there's a bit of Fallout 4 fan DLC, like a modding DLC, that was called the Storyteller DLC, and I was like that. And I think it's become very popular.
Was it just snippets of his dialogue all throughout?
No, I don't think it's got anything to do with Ron Perlman. I think it's just I haven't actually played it through, so I don't really know. I just saw it, like the guy's done some really cool stuff with modding the power armor. It'd be nice to bring Ron Perlman back and like give some background to that character.
Yeah.
We're talking about the DLCs. So what was the second DLC for Fallout 3? Was that?
I don't know the chronological order, but
was that Anchorage?
Could have been Anchorage, actually. I think Anchorage, yeah, because I think they had the fun one. Anchorage and Mothership Zeta were the two fun ones out of those. Whereas
Pit and Point Lookout
The Pit was good enough to be a standalone game.
I think Pit was the third one. Point Lookout was the fourth one.
And then Mothership Zeta was the
final one. Actually, to be fair, the storytelling for Mothership Zeta and for Anchorage was pretty poor. It was just a case of like, here's some things to blow up, and here's some cool laser shit.
I think they were just fun arcade style DLCs as opposed to ones that offered pretty good storylines.
Yeah,
I especially liked Point Lookout. Point Lookout, I loved the fact that it was all a game between these people who were just hunting each other.
Yeah, I mean, I think...
And Desmond was just, even though he was a bastard, was such a likeable character.
I think you're right in saying that the Pit was the best DLC for Fallout 3.
Yeah.
Story-wise, definitely. I mean, like, there was obviously the thing, like, story-wise it was the most interesting with, like, the idea of, like, a radiation-immune kid and, you know, raiders, like, had a purpose rather than just raiding crap.
Yeah.
And the Pit as, like, a kind of industrial superpower in the post-apocalypse, potentially, and the, you know, the resurrection of the manufacturing industries and stuff like that.
That would look... You know, bringing back the subject of a Fallout 3 remaster, that would look fantastic. Because that was the one thing I was thought, because I always played it on the PS3, so I don't know what the PC high-end graphics look like, but the PS3 just never seemed to do it enough justice.
Yeah.
A remaster on that would look fantastic.
The Pit, I mean, the Pit, could, like you said, could almost have functioned as its own game. That could have been a Fallout setting in its own right.
Yeah. It could be, you know, a more successful version of Blood Dragon or something like that.
To be honest, it might well be for Fallout 5. When we get on to talking about Fallout 5, that is a genuine possibility that we could be set in the remnants of
Pittsburgh.
That you could be set in the remnants of the decision the Lone Wanderer's made for Pittsburgh.
Yeah. That would be really good.
That would also give it a very like Metro Last Light feel, like everything much more claustrophobic. And that's also a good way to return to that Fallout 3 kind of claustrophobic.
Yeah, speaking of which, that was one of my favourite things about Fallout 3 as well, the metro system.
Yeah.
Loved it.
It was much... Yeah, whereas Fallout 4 doesn't really have that. It has got trains and stuff like that, but like they're not as interconnected as the metro system was in Fallout 3.
It's just the sneaky... Especially, you know, if Fallout 3 was your first game, which I'm imagining quite a lot of people, Fallout 3 was their first experience. Not many people knew of it really beforehand, especially console gamers who wouldn't have played it on PC. You know, it's one of your like third or fourth main quests is to sneak into Galaxy News Radio, and you have to go through a metro, and that's when you first meet the ghouls.
Yeah.
That entire sequence. That was great. Fantastic. I loved it.
And they get the giant super mutant behemoth just runs through Galaxy News Radio like
Tiny dude is big now.
And he's big now.
Yep. Okay. Oh yeah, they were fun to kill.
And you know, Point Lookout was great. I liked Desmond as a character. With Point Lookout, there's something to talk about there. And like, there is that very weird. It's almost like the formalization of that very weird Lovecraftian element that there is lurking underneath the Fallout games. Yeah, there is some kind of weird link to the magical spiritual world there.
Yeah, because it did link back because you had the book from, I can't remember, Black Something Manor.
Yeah, the Necronomicon or whatever it's called.
Yeah, and you would go back to the Dunwick building in...
And Dunwick, the Dunwick building itself is an Easter egg, and I think Dunwick is a name from one of the Lovecraft books.
Well, yeah, because when you go down into the basement, you see I believe it's like a statue of a woman and people kneeling towards it, which I honestly don't know off the top of my head, but it's referencing something.
Fallout New Vegas dropped it, I think. I can't, off the top of my head, I can't remember a Lovecraft reference in that.
I think there was actually one.
Was there?
I know Fallout 4 had another reference to the Dunwick building.
Oh, Fallout 4 had loads. Fallout 4 had the entire quarry sequence where you hallucinate the cultists.
Yeah.
And Kremva's tooth.
Fallout New Vegas had something. Obviously, I think it was only accessible with the Wild Wasteland perk, but it definitely had something creepy in it.
Fallout 4 also had the link to... The aliens are behind the Lovecraft shit as well, because they had the Cabot storyline, where like you meet Mr. Cabot Senior and he's got like the weird alien space helmet thing from like the I think it's like the ruins of Iran. I think he says where it is from. And like it's implied to be one of the, like the Zetan like artifacts that like caused all this crap. But that's done up in a very Lovecraftian way. I don't know. I mean, I'll tell you what though. In fairness to the sequels, 2, 4, 3, I thought the DLC for New Vegas, were the as a collection, were the strongest pack of DLC.
Up until the end, I think they.
Up until Lonesome Road.
Yeah, it was. Lonesome Road. It was a bit of a letdown at the end of Lonesome Road. The thing is, I loved going through Lonesome Road as well. Actually, following the path was fantastic. Going through all the remnants of these old things as well. Just the story with Ulysses at the end just kind of let itself down a bit.
A massive letdown.
Especially what it set out. Dead Money was one of my absolute favourite
DLCs. Dead Money
DLCs.
Was brilliant.
I loved it.
I was a big fan of Old World Blues.
Yeah, Old World Blues was good. That purely because of the title. Typical New Vegas wacky.
Yeah, purely because of Muggsy. Muggsy is my favourite character in any video game ever. Muggsy was brilliant.
And he hates himself.
But like, I really want them to bring Muggsy back. I think Muggsy is just a great character.
Is it Muggsy or is it Muggy?
Muggy's Muggy?
I think it's Muggy.
Is it Muggy? Or like
Muggsy? No, he just mugs people when they walk in.
Like Muggy's obsession with mugs.
Oh. The thing is, as soon as I knew about that DLC, as soon as I played it once on a future playthroughs of Fallout New Vegas, yeah, every time I saw a coffee cup, I'd hoard it. And then as soon as I would go to Old World Blues, I'd
give them all to Muggy.
Dump all of my gear at the Lucky 38, apart from about 200 coffee cups, and just, oh, here, have these. Oh. Never seen a little robot come in his pants so much.
It's weird as well, because like it's, Fallout New Vegas should have had a better story than Fallout 3, in a sense. Like, it had a better villain. Like, House, Robert House, is a much better villain than Eden was.
But was he a villain, though? Because he could be a villain, or he could be your ally. Some people end up working for him.
I mean, yeah, but like, even when you're working for him, like, he's pretty upright, upfront, Robert.
He's very evil master type.
Yeah, he's very upfront about the fact that he thinks democracy's failed, and like, they should go back to just him telling everyone what to do.
I mean, to be fair, it was a democratic place, and, you know, they're in a wasteland.
Yeah, true. Well, I mean, arguably it wasn't actually that democratic by the end.
Yeah.
Because of all the crap that went down. But yeah, Robert House is a sociopath, so, you know, take what he says with a grain of salt.
Really? Sociopath? He's only got 2 sex robots. And one of them isn't Fister.
One of them isn't in the game. They're only mentioned. Because there's the one that's meant to be Marilyn Monroe, and then there's the one that's meant to be...
How she went looking for her down in his basement.
She's not there. She's in the if you could go hunting around the coding, she's in there. Like, if you go, you know, digging through the files, she is there.
That's some dedication for an AI.
Yeah, but she's not in the actual game, sadly. Even though she is referenced. They have a character.
It's referenced by Veronica.
Yeah, Veronica talks about the fact that she's surprised he only had 2 sex robots. Like, he did? I thought he only had 1. Did I miss something?
Also, how does Veronica know?
Well, I mean, who do you think designed it?
The Brotherhood of Steel had to make it for them.
So, yeah, someone made Fisto. Let's not forget.
Someone sat alone at their workbench creating Fisto.
Oh, God, yeah. And also what New Vegas had that was a benefit over Fallout 3 was the karma system was a bit more, made a bit more sense. Like, it was like factions could turn against you. Like, you had reputations with particular factions.
Yeah, as opposed to just, oh, he's kind of a bad guy. Let's all collectively hate him for 3 days until we can't remember his face.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, there was... I mean, the other things as well was, like, you know, there was the Wild Wasteland perk, which in my mind, they shouldn't have made a perk. It should have just been the default game. Yeah. But, like, that was brilliant, and I love the fact that that was there, and that gave it a slight edge on Fallout 3. But the reason Fallout 3 is a better game overall is that Fallout 3 was much, much better at taking all of its collective elements and making them a coherent experience.
Whereas it's New Vegas, atmosphere of it.
Yeah, whereas New Vegas, it tried to build a different atmosphere, and it sort of succeeded, but the problem was it was too... It was a kid in a sweet shop. It didn't know which way it wanted you to turn. It didn't know what thing it wanted to offer you first. And unlike Fallout 3, which had a very clear end goal in mind,
yeah,
New Vegas was just like, oh, no, just do whatever, man. And it became sloppy as a result.
The same with Fallout 4 as well. And I was watching a review on it by Yahtzee Croshaw.
Yeah.
And that's exactly it. Just, you know, you pay for the game, you buy the game. You kind of want it to lead you in the direction that you're supposed to go and give you the experience, as opposed to plonking you somewhere and just going, yeah, do what you want, have fun.
Yeah.
Especially Fallout 4 as well, especially with the crafting system and things like that.
Yeah.
Fallout 4, which was hit and miss. Yeah. Fallout 4's crafting system, I can see how that's a lot of fun, but in terms of an actual Fallout aspect.
Well, here's the thing, like, it's fun. It's I think Fallout 4 again has suffered from what is a fair, not even particularly unique to Fallout. It's just a thing that happens a lot with games that are more expansive upon the original. Like Assassin's Creed 2 is sort of the same thing, you know, that like they wanted to introduce a whole bunch of new elements, and some of them are polished and some of them aren't because they didn't know quite what to do with them. I think Fallout 5 will feel the benefits of the moves Fallout 4 made, and if they can bring back the atmosphere of Fallout 3, then the whole package would be incredible.
If it has the direction that it had in Fallout 3...
Yeah, but with all the perks that Fallout... And a polishing of all the perks that you got from Fallout 4.
Game of the year.
Because, you know, like, you and I both have an idea of what... We were discussing this when we were going to talk about Fallout 5 and what we want from it, because we had an idea as to how to improve those particular features and link it into the story.
Yeah.
But we'll get onto that in a bit. Before we get there, we need to wrap up the DLC conversation with just Fallout 4's DLC.
Yeah, Fallout 4's DLC. So you have Far Harbor, which is essentially Point Lookout.
Number two.
Yeah. Little bit shitter, but still pretty fun, pretty enjoyable. Well,
it's weird in that they take the most interesting element of the story in the Far Harbor story and sort of abandon it, which is that is Kasumi a synth? Like, because that's the big question that the entirety of Fallout 4 throws at you is like, does it matter if you're a synth or not? Is a synth any different to a person? and whatever. And like, that's, I mean, again, they don't ever, to be fair, they never really satisfyingly answer that in Fallout's.
Just actually, halfway through, just fuck it.
There's an abandoned plotline, which is a much better way of exploring that, which I'll get onto in a second, which they actually ended up cutting, which is really irritating. But they try to then flip on its head and be like, okay, but so there are people who think that other people, who suspect other people are being synths and hunt them, even when they're not. Because it doesn't work in reverse. Can you have people who think they're synths when they're not? You know, if you can't tell the difference between whether or not you're a synth, doesn't really matter. And like Kasumi, obviously, was set up as like, is she a synth? She thinks she is. Dima thinks she is, but... Well, no, Dima doesn't say whether he thinks she is, actually, in fairness. Dima just sort of, like, lets her roll with it. And and when you ask him about
Yeah, you can be what you want to be.
Yeah, and when you ask him about it, he's like, does it matter? And you're like, well, no, that's not the point. The point is, like, you know, she thinks she is. That's why she left her home.
Yeah.
She's only here because she thinks she is. And so it does sort of matter in this context. And it's never addressed. And... Yeah, that whole thing about Kasumi gets kind of left aside throughout the entirety of Far Harbor until you get to the end, and then she either dies, depending on who you side with. Like, the Brotherhood just come in and kill everyone, because the Brotherhood...
Yeah, the Brotherhood love to go around killing.
Yeah, because in Fallout 4, Maxon basically turned the Brotherhood into another enclave.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just the enclave with the smiley face on it.
Yeah, literally. Well, you say that, Eden had a smiley face on enclave in Fallout 3.
That's true, and he had those little eyebots.
Little eyebots. It's just Maxon's turned into a fanatic by the time of Fallout 4. Which actually... I mean,
he did kill a Yao guy when he was 12.
Yeah, to be fair, I feel like that's an interesting way to take his character. I'm not sure I'd buy into the fact that Sarah Leon's apparently died like a bitch between the games.
Yeah, I mean, she was pretty damn hardcore.
Yeah, particularly as, like, Broken Steel's ending pretty firmly establishes that she's shipped with the Lone Wanderer.
Is she?
Yeah, well, I don't know if it's...
Well, it's kind of...
If the Lone Wanderer's a guy, I think she is. If the Lone Wanderer's a guy, there's dialogue that suggests that they're going to be a thing.
I don't know, it kind of... it tries to lead you... you know, astray with that, because there are also lines, things like, you know, if this was a different situation, we might have even been friends and things like that. It's kind of hard to tell the difference between that kind of militaristic camaraderie and actual relationship feelings.
I know, but like, it depends on how you play the game, but like, I'm pretty sure if you're a paragon and you have the right dialogue, there is dialogue that's pretty unambiguous about the fact that she's interested in Lone Wanderer. But like
that's just because my character's never been 100% clean. Yeah.
Not in a coming on sense, but I feel like she has a line about like, when this is all over, maybe you and I, we can see where things lead, or something like that. I'm pretty sure that was.
It's hard to find a future with a man who's addicted to buff out psycho mid X jet.
Hey,
horse blood.
It works for Arnie, so
fair point.
I say it works out, it hasn't really worked out. But yeah, so that was a Point Lookout, and it suffered basically from trying to be... Sorry, Far Harbor, suffered from trying to be Point Lookout again.
We had Nuka World, was it?
Nuka World was the last one, which I really enjoyed. The middle one, on the other hand... Well, no, there was two middle ones. The one was the robot workshop one.
Yeah, so you just get extra stuff, essentially.
Well, no, there's a plotline involving the Mechanist. Which they resurrected from Fallout 3, which actually, in fairness, was one
more
of the
nostalgia.
Was one of the funnier, wackier elements of Fallout 3.
Mechanist and the Antagonizer.
That was the thing. Like, I feel like they could have done a better job with that story. Like, you know, because they set the Mechanist up to be the villain, and then they end, obviously, spoiler alert, you know, they realize it's not, and the Mechanist is a girl and trying to just do her do her best to save the wasteland, not fucking over. Mm. Just doing a bad job of it. But like, it would have been a great third act twist if the antagonizer had just rocked up.
Yeah.
Like, it would have made a...
Don't worry, you're not a villain. You're just a shit bad guy.
Yeah, you're just a really shit good guy. But like, that would have been more fun. And I do like the fact that you can craft your own robots, even though it does make the settlers a bit pointless in your settlements. Like, I feel like there should have been a limit on how many robots you can make.
You just have robot friends for everything because they're more exciting than people persons.
Yeah, and also they're more efficient.
Yeah.
And also you don't have to wait. You don't have to feed them as well, which you have to do with the rest of your settlers, which is a pain in the ass.
Do you have to anyway? You can just sit there and watch them die.
Starve them to death.
I mean, I thought that was what The Sims was invented for.
They just get progressively more and more unhappy with you.
Fantastic. More reason to shoot them in the face. That child looked at me funny. Buckshot.
Well, there aren't children in Fallout. You can't kill the children in Fallout 4.
You can with mods.
Oh, you can.
That's one of the most... That must be one of the most downloaded mods on Fallout 4. I know it is in Skyrim. Killable kids.
Because they're so annoying.
Well, yeah, there's that bratty girl in Whiterun, to stray off topic very quickly, but that bratty girl in Whiterun, I'm pretty sure everyone downloaded that mod and stabbed her.
You know what I'm amazed I haven't done, though, in Fallout, is introduce a Fallout version of the Adoring Fan.
Oh.
Because I feel like it's sorely needed. Just a bit of catharsis for players just to kick the shit out of someone. Like Shooting McShootface in Borderlands.
Well, Deacon, as much as he tries to troll the sole survivor, just acts like the Adoring Fan, even though he hates his guts.
Well, there's a theory about Deacon, which again we'll get onto when we talk about the fan theories.
Yeah, that's the one we've been waiting for.
That is the one. I don't ascribe to it, but like it is an interesting theory.
But it's fun to think. It's fun to believe.
I have my own theory for what they should do with Lone Wanderer, which will come into how we should get into Fallout 5.
I think we all know. I think most people, just to give a little taster of things like that, most people want to see a fight between
a previous
main character and the current main character of whatever game.
I mean, it's not too much of a spoiler for my idea for Fallout 5 that I think Lone Wanderer should be the villain of Fallout 5.
Yeah, because there's absolutely no evidence to suggest that he's perished because it's only 10 years.
Villain in the sense of being the antagonist, like whether or not his motivation to villainous should be left up for that very Fallout-y kind of morally grey debate.
Yeah.
Rather than just being unequivocally a nutcase, which wouldn't really fit his previous excursions.
Or it would, depending on how you played.
Depending on how you played it.
If you played like you bombed a city for a nice hotel room.
I mean, to be fair, though, in the canon, he's not a dick, because Project Purity is a thing in the canon, because they mention it in Fallout 4.
Yeah, that's true. And the Wasteland Survival Guide as well. Yeah. That's canon.
That's canon as well. So clearly he wasn't a dick.
Yeah.
At least not an entirely a dick.
Bethesda are no fun.
Well, like, yeah, there was that. The DLC for that was, off the robot one, sorry, there was the contraptions, which was just, extra stuff.
Yeah.
And then there was, I suppose there was one other story one before Nuka World, which I can't remember at the top of my head now. Christ almighty, I'll come back to it. But yeah, so we'll move on from that to go to Nuka World. Nuka World was pretty good.
Nuka World was pretty fun.
I did enjoy Nuka World. I enjoyed Nuka World a lot. And I think that was by far and away, interestingly enough, I think the story of Nuka World was far more interesting than the story of Fallout 4.
Yeah.
I wanted to spend a lot more time in Fallout, in the Nuka World, than I did in the Wasteland in Fallout 4.
And they brought back that crazy bitch as well.
Who?
The crazy bitch. She was just, she was in Fallout 3 as well. She was just obsessed with Nuka-Cola.
Oh, jumpsuit girl.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have the option to kill.
Yeah.
Yeah, which I totally did, because she's so annoying.
Is there anyone you didn't kill?
I didn't kill Dogmeat. You killed Dogmeat, so actually, in the scale of monsters, you are the worst.
Oh, yeah, of course. You know, an entire city blown up, one dog.
Yeah, but the thing is, the people of that city are all religious cultists who want to be blown up, so really, I was doing them a favour.
They're not all. Lucas Sims was pretty cool. What about Moira?
Well, Sims dies anyway, doesn't he?
What about Gob?
Well, Sims dies anyway.
No, you can save him.
Okay, well, he dies...
You can save him with precognition. If you know what Burke's about to do, you can jump in the way and shoot Burke in the face.
Yeah, but like otherwise he dies.
He's supposed to die.
He's scripted to die there.
Yeah, but you can just be an asshole and change fate.
They're all assholes. And like in that city, they're either all assholes like Moriarty, or they're...
No, you won't!
I'm convinced that's where they got that idea for Moriarty from, because he's literally like that. Yeah. Or they're all cultists. Even What's-Her-Face, the Wasteland Survival guy.
Yeah, Moira.
Moira. Yeah, ghoul Moira is hilarious.
But what about
she survives? She survives being blown up.
I know.
She becomes a ghoul.
She's like, oh, what's this on my face? Why is it coming off in strips? That's your face, Moira. You've got lovely cheekbones.
But like, if you just follow them around, like any of the random townsfolk, they start saying stuff like bathe in atoms glow. And you're like, okay, fine. If that's what you want, guys, screw it.
Right. Have a plasma grenade while you're at it.
That, frankly, the entire cult of Atom is pretty fucking weird, and they all deserve to go up in smoke, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, yeah, but why don't you just shoot the professor and leave it at that?
Because I would rather shoot High Confessor, what's-his-face, Tectus from Fallout 4.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you
can't really do that in Fallout 3. That's not one of the add-ons. No, just quickly true. Jump to the
Fallout
game
and shoot them,
many years down the line.
But, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, Nuka World was... Actually, no, out of all the DLCs and all of the Fallouts, I think Dead Money and Nuka World are probably my favourites.
Dead Money's definitely up there.
Dead Money,
the Pit.
Oh, and the Pit. Sorry, I forgot the Pit. Yeah, Dead Money, the Pit, and Nuka World are by far and away the most interesting ones.
I think Point Lookout as well, just because I love running around massacring hillbillies with a shotgun.
Before we go on to the next topic, which is the Fallout TV show, we are going to take a small break. We're going to take a small break, and we'll be back shortly.
We're not going to eat, I swear.
We are in no way going to go off and rot and make love.
It might be steamy when you come back.
We might be out of breath.
If your computer screen fogs up, it's not us.
It's Dogmeat.
I think that's a good place to end it here.
When we get back, we will be talking about the Fallout TV show. We'll be talking about the characters we most liked and most hated in Fallout. We'll be talking about several Fallout fan theories. And we're going to round off the whole thing by talking about Fallout 5 and where we think it should be set and the fan theories about where it's going to be set.
So have a think now. Don't worry, you don't have to sit through this pause.
Hello and welcome back to the second part of our podcast, our beautiful, wonderful podcast that just makes me so happy and cry.
Very child-friendly.
Very
blissful.
Extremely child-friendly, exactly the sort of thing you play in a class full of primary school kids.
It's not the worst thing you could play.
No, it's also not the worst group of kids you could probably find, like little lamplight, I'm looking at you.
Yeah. What have they done?
All sorts of horrible things. They don't mention a vault full of super mutants and somehow don't get eaten. I don't understand this.
Because they're all so fucking vile.
Speaking of the characters who are vile, that's the first thing we will be talking about in the second part. Is thank you. I'd like to dedicate this award to Dogmeat.
May he rest in peace 27 times.
No, Dogmeat, no. You leave Dogmeat alone, you monster.
Too late.
So we'll be talking about our three favourite characters from the Fallout series and our three least favourite characters. I think it would be better for comedy's sake if we start off with our three favourite. So, Geordi, would you like to go first?
I'd have to say Sharon, probably be my favourite character
from
Underworld.
Oh my god, yeah, no, okay.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful
god, that
man.
Back.
Yeah, I love that guy. I remember walking through into Underworld for the first time in Fallout 3 and just thinking, guy stood in the corner and he's got a shotgun. I want to be his friend. Because he's always scripted to be a fucking giant as well. So your character can be in the biggest piece of armour. And Sharon just makes him look like a tiny matchstick man. It's fantastic. You walk up to him in T-51B armor and he just dwarfs you. He's got to be my favorite. Followed by...
Dun, 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 dun. I feel like we should have a mysterious strange like noise just in here now.
Does he count as a character?
And he's a character because Valentine is after him. So
So he's got to be real. He's not a figment of the many players' imagination.
Yeah, he's not just like some kind of awful like Vietnam, like thousand yard stare PTSD moment.
He came out of the trees again and again.
He looked like Sylvester Stallone. I was so confused.
I'd say Mysterious Stranger, actually, for number two. And
that's a great shout.
Three. What's his name? Dean Domino from Dead Money.
Oh, okay.
The sassy as shit.
Dean
girl.
Domino, he's a great character. Okay. I find him a bit irritating after a while. Like, he's funny for the first, like, half of the Dead Money, and then he gets on my nerves.
Ah, I like him all the way through. Just because he takes... Have you ever seen him, in the first part when you send all three of them to the fountain?
Yeah.
He walks up to Christine, who's got all those scars over
her.
He's just half tries chatting her up, and then he's just like, nah, she's ugly, I'm going to sass her.
Yeah. God, who are my favourite characters? Okay, well, first of all, I'm going to go with my bro, Nick Valentine.
Oh, yeah.
Nick Valentine, I do think, is a class act.
Get past the voice of Mercer Frey, though.
But he's so good. I would say Boone from New Vegas, because I had a strong bromance with Boone.
I did. Boone and Raoul as well, they were both good.
Yeah, but on balance, I think Boone is too one note for me to put him in my favourites.
He's watched every single Clint Eastwood film and felt a bit guilty. Yeah.
I'm not gonna say Dogmeat, because as much as I love Dogmeat, he's not really a character. He doesn't speak.
Not in mine, he's a paste.
Oh, God. You leave Dogmeat alone! I hate you.
I know.
Just like Anakin style. I hate you!
Yeah, well, I've got the high ground.
It's over, Anakin. I have the moral high ground.
Oh, shit, my legs.
God, who would be my second favourite character then? I was a big fan, just for the comedy value, of the think tanks from the Old World Blues.
It's waving up a hand of fully erect hand penises.
Yeah, literally. Just for a comedy sake, I think I'm going to have to collectively refer to the think tanks as my second favourite characters ever in Fallout.
They did creep me out, though. The female one creeped me out. The way she calls you teddy bear and comes up to you just to examine you.
It's not... Morbius is the most... Morbius is the rogue one.
Yeah.
Zero and Klein and... Oh, God. They've all got names that reference Infinity.
Darla, is it?
Oh, yeah, because it's Mandala. She's taken from the Tibetan Mandala things.
Yeah.
They've all got names that reference Infinity. Like, Klein is the name of a scientist who came up with a 3D version of the Mobius strip.
Yeah.
And obviously the Mobius strip is the Mobius strip. And then, like...
Dr. Zero, divide by zero.
Yeah. He's the silent one, isn't he? The one who can't speak.
No, that's Dr. 8.
Is that Dr. 8?
Yeah.
Yeah, because
he can speak. He can speak in those weird-ass patterns, and you can just open him up and violate him.
Yeah.
That's literally a line of text. Just, oh, yeah, it won't take me long to violate your rights.
The think tanks were pretty classic. Who's the third? I'm tempted for the comedy value to say the original Machinist and Antagonizer, just because they were so jokes. Especially when you told them, if you could, you know, when you persuaded them to give it up.
Yeah, they just like kind of walked away.
Scolded children. They just fucked off with the ants. Like,
alright, fine.
I did like Sarah Lyons. I did used to have a bit of a thing for a martyr, but then a martyr just turns into a white. Oh, actually, you know who it is? Butch.
Butch, yeah.
Tunnel Snakes Butch is...
Tunnel Snakes rules!
Yeah, it's classic. He's the closest we've had to an adoring fan, to be honest. But, like, he is great. Yeah, I'm going to say Butch. I'll plump for Butch. I do quite like him.
I just love how your character's 10 years old, yet he still teases him about his alcoholic mum.
What kind of 10-year-old does that?
Like, no wonder Butch is a bully. You're an ass.
Yeah, you deserve it. Fucking sociopath.
I mean, I'd like to put important caveats. Which, like, I've left aside, apart from the think tanks, because they are technically human beings.
Yeah.
I've left aside the robot characters, and I've left aside the dog characters. Because
Otherwise, I would have said Eddie.
Yeah, I'm a huge Eddie fan. Also, I'm a huge Codsworth fan as well from Fallout 4. Yeah. Codsworth is my man.
Sir, you are 273 years late for your dinner.
Yeah, he knows my name. He says my name. So, like, he calls me by my name. No other Fallout.
But he can't do it by mine.
Clancy. I don't think Clancy's one of the options. No, sorry.
Well, why would he do my surname?
Well, I don't think Geordie's one of the options either.
No.
Dig in, motherfucker.
Fuck the Irish.
I think Alex is definitely one, so screw you.
Nah, I never heard it before. Was it French?
Yeah, no, it's Swahili. I don't know why I keep referencing Swahili, but like...
Oh my god.
I secretly want to be Swahili. Okay, who are your three least favourite characters? Who are the three characters you hate the most?
Oh.
The most annoying, the most irritating, the ones you just want to drop kick off the top of, like, the DC monument.
Oh. Well, if we're including Mysterious Stranger, you remember the perk that was supposed to be the counterpart to that in Fallout New Vegas, Misfortune. So it was the same Mysterious Stranger effect. She would turn up in the middle of the battle. However, there was a 50-50 chance she could shoot your energy, or I'll start that one again. She could shoot your enemy.
Yeah.
Or she could just decide for shits and giggles she's going to attack you.
Oh, yes.
I'm not sure if that's how she was meant to be or if it's just how she worked on mine, but she was a cunt. There were so many times and I was just like, right, I'll use Vats. Hopefully the Mysterious Stranger. I'm dead. Great.
Like, cheers, Misfortune, screw you.
Legate Linnaeus.
Linnaeus.
Linnaeus, however you want to fucking say it. Just because he was...
Is he really much of a character?
Robbing bellend of a person.
You can persuade him to fuck off.
Well, exactly. That's my problem with him. He's this leader of these. He puts, you know, the story of the Burn Man... He failed at his job, so he was set on fire and thrown into the fucking canyon.
I forgot about Burnman.
Yet this guy just,
Joshua,
you know...
Graham, he's badass.
He will exchange words with the courier, and after about a 5-minute conversation, he'll just saying, no, just fuck off back east.
I'm going to put another caveat on my list of likes, and I think Graham should... He's not on my top three, but I do love Graham. It's a bit like I like the... He's not. You don't see him in the game, but the guy who the tribe have... based their father figure guy on,
Daniel.
Yeah, the ex-US soldier who got caught after the blast.
Yeah.
Yeah, you find his remains.
Oh, yeah, I know him. Not Daniel, it's the survivalist.
Yeah, the survivalist. Yeah.
His audio log, not his audio log, just his normal notes.
He was cool.
Third would... It just have to be Preston Garvey.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to be honest, number one on my list of hates is Preston Garvey. If I could... I'm so disappointed you can't kill him.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I know you can mod him to be non-essential and then kill him, but, like, he's just...
That's too much effort. He's not worth it.
And in fairness, I do like the fact that he can get back after I've beaten him silly, so I can beat him silly again. But, like... Yeah.
But you could just spawn 100 of them.
Preston is one. I think the second one's going to be a bit contentious, because I know a lot of people like this character, which is the King from New Vegas. I really disliked the King from New Vegas, just because I found him so grating.
I didn't... Yeah, I was a bit indifferent towards him.
I stole his clothes, but, like...
Of course you did.
I left him alive. I pickpocketed his clothes.
I mean, Pacer was the real bastard in those two.
That's true. Kellogg's a bastard, but I quite like him as a character.
Mm.
He's interesting, at least.
Cereal's a bit shit.
Oh, God. Autumn's not really enough of a character for me to dislike him. Three Dog has got to be on there.
Bow Wow.
Yeah, Preston and Three Dog are by far and away the two ones I openly dislike the most. Three Dog, I'm so glad they didn't bring him back for Fallout 4. I hope he doesn't come back for Fallout 5. He needs to sort off and die.
I think he was supposed to be back for Fallout 4 as well, though.
Yeah,
but then
he boasted about it and they cut him. they gave over to... why is the guy Diamond City Radio guy called? The really weedy dude who you can make into an arrogant smug dick. Because I can't remember his name, but that guy, with the caveat of when he's shy, I like him. And it's funny listening to Diamond City Radio when he's like not really sure of himself, because he's just like sitting there being mopey and depressing. It's a bit like listening to Eeyore on the radio.
And then as soon as he gets a little bit confident.
Yeah, you just make him into a smug dick and he behaves like a tool and I hate him. He becomes Three Dog and like... Yeah, I'm going to stick with that.
But Three Dog was just a douche in the game as well. Just, oh yeah, you know, this important thing that could benefit the entire wasteland. What's it worth to you? Yeah. You know, I'm going to barter with you for it.
To be fair, James is a bit... If you like, other than the fact he's always on Liam Neeson, James is a massive tool in Fallout 3.
He paid Moriarty for something so ridiculous, I think.
Yeah.
Whereas his son then comes along a little bit after his dad and is just like, no, I'm just going to fucking steal it.
Yeah. Or the Overseer from 101.
Oh, yeah. Well, that pissed me off as well.
We forgot Gary. Gary! We forgot Gary, right?
Yeah, Gary's on a pedestal.
Gary, okay, yeah, Gary.
You can have your top three, but Gary
Gary's separate. Gary is, my God.
Every single Gary.
Gary!
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 My sister's going to listen to this through the door and hear us shouting Gary. She'll know exactly what we're talking about, because I've made that joke a billion times.
She still doesn't get it, though.
Still, no, I think she's seen Gary. Who knows who Gary is? There are Gary references in Fallout 4.
Gary?
Ooh.
Hilariously, because he's become like his own entity now.
How many people cosplay as Gary each year, do you
know what's interesting, though? There are a bunch of like characters that you never hear about, you never meet, who I really wanted to run into in the various games. One, obviously, you can't, because you meet the older pair in the older half of that gang in Tenpenny Tower, which is I can't remember his name, but the adventures of What's-His-Face with...
Herbert Daring Dashwood.
Yeah, and the ghoul.
And Argyle.
Argyle. You can find Argyle's body, actually. You can find...
yeah, it's in Rockopolis.
Rockopolis. You can find the remains
of Rockopolis. You can tell Fallout 3 is my favourite.
Yeah, you can find Rockopolis. I'd like to have seen Rockopolis, so, like...
Yeah.
The Puppet Man... Did you know about Puppet Man?
Puppet Man.
Puppet Man is like, so he's from one of the vaults where the experiment was, they locked up one guy with just a crate full of puppets and let the doors close. And like after a year, he went nuts, opened the box of puppets and just made like these imaginary things. And then they started like taking him over and he breaks out of the vault with like the puppet telling him to do shit. And like he gets captured by slavers. And then the puppet tells him to kill them all. And he like carved his way through all the slavers. And if you go to Paradise Falls in... Fallout 3, you can find the jumpsuit from the vault he's from with a note saying burn this because the slavers are terrified of him. And I'd like to have seen Puppet Man. And it's also a bit like, there's a similar thing in Fallout 4 where if you listen in on the raiders talking, they start talking about a guy called Grenade Man, who's apparently like the biggest troll on the wasteland, because he runs around throwing rocks at people and then shouts grenade and runs away. And I was like, I just want to meet that guy. I really hope that's the Lone Wanderer, just like how he's spending his days.
I love in Point Lookout, the DLC, they set up if you walk around, you see all these newspaper clippings about the pint-sized slasher, and you think it's just backstory, and then you actually go somewhere.
Yeah.
No, you find him. Like, you actually get attacked by him.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, there's a place where you actually get attacked by him.
Oh, my goodness. Because I know you can put on his mask and go around being the pint-sized slasher in the Tranquility Lane simulation.
Can you?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever done Point Lookout before I've done the Tranquility Lane.
No, Tranquility Land, like, I mean, regardless of which order you do it in, you can, the pint-sized slasher is in Tranquility Land. If you listen to Braum's instructions and just carry on and do the evil way and don't just glitch your way out and fuck him over.
Oh, I always do the failsafe.
Yeah, I always do the failsafe as well. But if you don't do the failsafe, then you the ending thing is that you have to walk around dressed as the pint-sized slasher killing everyone. So he existed before.
Do you wake up and your dad's disappointed in you again?
Yeah, he is upset with you. and Braum gets to go on being an evil bastard. Frankly, though, anyone who signed up for the Vault Experiments deserves it, in my opinion, so...
Yeah. I love, there are these videos on YouTube, and it's, your dad from Fallout 3 calls up the water company, and they just use these pre-recorded audio files. It's just like, I'm looking for Dr. Stanislaus Braun. We don't have anyone by that name. And one of them just goes, you're looking for Boone? And then it's just a picture of Boone pops up. Fucking brilliant.
Yeah, so before we move on to the next discussion, with a Fallout TV series potential, we should talk about oh Christ, I completely lost myself. No, not Fallout 5, that's gonna be our ending one. The Vaults, that's the one, the Vaults. And Vault Tech and the Great Vault Experiment, which is what the actual fuck is up with the Vaults.
Who the fuck commissioned it?
Well, like it's was produced in association with the Enclave before they buggered off, but like
in case you needed a tiny bit more evidence to suggest that the Enclave were cunts.
Well, because wasn't that the original idea? Was that the original plan for the Enclave wasn't to stay on Earth. It was to take a fucking rocket off to Mars and, like, terraform it. And,
wasn't
like,
that the Ghouls in New Vegas?
Yeah, and, like, and the idea was that the Vault experiments were supposed to be experiments for, like, dealing with various bits of spaceflight shit, which is fucking mad, because, like, you get Vault with, like, a one man and a leopard. So, like...
yeah, when's that ever going to come about on the moon?
I missed that bit in The Martian, I'm going to be honest.
yeah, it's a deleted scene.
But yeah, the thousand women and one man scenario.
The leopard just climbs on top, looks him dead in the eyes.
Matt Damon! yeah, the panther's like, Bagheera! so that was the official explanation, which is obviously some horseshit. And like, yeah, like there doesn't seem to be any point to the Vault experiments beyond just making people go crazy and die. Or like exposing them to FEV or whatever.
It just seems like a very expensive, widespread cause of shits and giggles.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, like, there are strong concepts in the games, and, like, the exploring the Vault is a big part of the games.
Well, Vault 101 was the only semi-normal one, just...
No, there are control vaults. Like, we haven't found any yet, but there are... Oh, no, there's one. We did find one. There is a control vault, I think, in New Vegas that you find. But, like, or, like, one that was being built, like, that wasn't finished. But, like, there are some control vaults. No, Fallout 3 you find it. It's the vault, testing vault. In Vault Tech headquarters.
Oh, yeah, of course, in headquarters.
Yeah.
Well, actually, what was Vault 22 or 21 even in Fallout New Vegas?
Is that the one underneath the casino?
Yes, in the strip.
Oh, no, that was the experiment was like they have to resolve everything through gambling, and the only people who were allowed in were gambling addicts. But that thing is, that was a successful vault because actually it ran perfectly and no one died.
Yeah.
So, like, that works. Vault 101 was obviously just never open.
Yeah.
Oh, no, here's one vault. There is a control vault, which is the vault you start off with in the very first Fallout game.
There's
a control vault.
Yeah, the only reason you go out is because your purifier is gone.
The chip breaks, yeah.
Yeah.
Unless that was the experiment, just, you know, carrying the vault for 100 years, then the chip breaks.
Yeah, and then see what one of those guys would do outside.
Yeah. Like, and I know some of them, like, obviously, like, Sandy Shade, the vault was designed not to close properly. And the ghouls there went off to become Necropolis, I think, later on. There's various, like, there's the music vault, which is obviously the white noise experiment, and,
oh, yeah, that's with all the, Mylocs.
I'll tell you what I think the creepiest vault has been so far, is the vault with sacrifice, the sacrifice vault.
Yeah, where... especially when you walk down that long chamber, just like, what the fuck's going on?
Yeah, well, like, the fact that, like, the four of them make it out, and, the, you know, they hear that final message being like, you are a paragon of humanity, you didn't sacrifice anyone, and the last four people are like, oh my god, what the fuck?
Oh.
Oh, no, it's five of them, and it's interesting because, like...
There's four
skeletons and only four gunshots in the recording, so one of them clearly didn't go through with it.
Yeah.
That would be interesting to see if him turning up. Father Elijah was pretty much an angel. Like, a lot of the stuff he was interested in was, like, Vault Tech stuff.
And money.
Yeah, House had his own thing, he didn't have vaults. But, like, there are vaults fucking everywhere, man.
Yeah.
I think I can't remember the official number it is. Like, there's 160, I think, vaults or something like that.
Well, vaults seem, especially in New Vegas, it seemed like a forgotten concept. It seemed like it was a really strong thing
in Fallout 3
because you were actually it was part of the main quest to dive into different vaults, and obviously several other side quests had a bunch of vault missions in them as well. Whereas in Fallout New Vegas, they were just kind of there.
They're incidental, yeah. Fallout 4, you do obviously they're a bigger thing again because, like, Vault 88 is. Or is it Vault 87 is a city now. That was a vault that actually turned out fairly okay.
Yeah.
There's one vault in Fallout New Vegas that is important, which is the one that the Nellis Air Force Base people are from.
Yeah, the boomers.
Boomers, yeah.
Yeah.
Because that was the weapon shitloaded one.
Yeah, just what would we do with these guys if we armed them to fuck?
Yeah, if we honestly, there's the drug addiction one as well in Fallout 4, which is a fucking awful, like, grim experiment. Like, we'll just lock them up with, like, no drugs and then suddenly expose a tunnel to loads of drugs, see what happens. Yeah. What's kind of hilarious, though, is, like, one of the people in the vault was just there by Vault-Tec to report on everyone, and they get killed. And you're like, well, Vault-Tec screw their own employees over, as actually evidenced by Vault-Tec rep dude from Fallout 4, who you can find wandering the wasteland 200 years later.
As a ghoul.
Incredibly annoyed with how things have turned out.
Well, yeah, that's the brilliant thing. When it's at the, when it's still in the pre-war scene, you can, when you run through the military checkpoint to get to the vault, he's just like, but I'm Vault-Tec, let me in. No, you're not on the list. But please.
You know what's interesting, though? There's power armor dudes on the skeletons outside.
Mm.
Like, what the fuck happened to that? Anyway, presumably they survived the initial blast and just bugged off.
Yeah.
That's
where the Brotherhood of Steel initiates from.
No, they're from, they're from Mariposa. They're from the Mariposa Air Force Base. The first Maxon dude was from there.
Yeah.
Although presumably there aren't any Maxons left now, because if you kill the Brotherhood in Fallout 4, that's the last Maxon. He is the last one. And frankly, you should, because Arthur Maxon's a fucking douche.
And he's got a dickish haircut.
Yeah, and
anyone who's got that haircut, I'm sorry, but
he's trying too hard to be Tom Hardy, basically, in Fallout 4. Right, so from there, let's sign quickly onto the Fallout TV show concept.
Yeah, we've seen attempts at this quite a lot on YouTube.
On YouTube? Because there's two big ones. There's Red Star and there's Revelation.
I can't remember the name of the one I watched. I remember it was a few years ago, at least now, the main one I watched. We agreed on the point that both of them had fantastic ideas for story, things like that. Fantastic concept, and the attention to detail in them were really good, but the execution was mainly lacking. It seemed very amateuristic, which obviously you can expect because it was an amateur film.
And it's a pilot, yeah.
Yeah. God, you don't want to listen to our pilot.
God. The Fallout is a universe, I think, which is long. And it's interesting because obviously the big thing with video game adaptions, and we've seen it with Assassin's Creed and Max Payne and Prince of Persia, and it's very. And you know,
Crash Bandicoot,
Tomb Raider, and we're getting another Tomb Raider next year, which is like, again, which is, they've just ripped off the video game for that. It's the same story. Which is not, I'm not complaining, but it's just, you know, we have yet to see video games done right in film. Really, I can't think of a single one that I think is genuinely a knockout.
Well, because film doesn't seem, you can't sum up a video game in a film, really. That's the
Yeah, which is why I think a universe like Fallout is actually the best possible option you have, because like it's a very idiosyncratic art style. It's very 1950s Americana nostalgia, which, let's be honest, in current America would play well. It's very wacky and fun, and it's also quite serious and dark. It sort of hits all the sweet spots. It's got the Walking Dead-esque kind of like grimness. It's also got, and like the road-esque kind of grimness. It's also got the wacky kind of fun-esque kind of like Gotham-ish kind of like silliness.
It's got some scope for horror if you wanted to go in that direction.
The art style's amazing. The lore's already set up for you, so you don't really have to like invent a whole new backstory for it.
No.
Because it's an open world game, you can just create your own story. Like, there's no central plot you need to link anything to. You can just create your own plot in that world.
Yeah, so no one's going to scream at you for going a different direction to what they did in the game.
You know what I would have done if I was Bethesda? Is, I mean, like, I'd have just created a Fallout TV series because I fucking love Fallout, but, like, I think a great way to do it, I mean, like, you know how they have, like, a 5-year gap between the Fallout games? Like, Fallout 3, then Fallout 4 was, like, 5 years, and then Fallout 4...
Fill that gap with five series of TV series. Yeah.
Like, but, like, have the main character... Have it be, like, the series be, like, the start of darkness. So, like, the villain in Fallout 5 is the protagonist of the Fallout TV show, and it's worse and worse with each series, season... And, you know, occasionally runs into characters from previous games, like Dr. Lee would be a great one. Or even, like, depending on when you set it, James or Moriarty or House or, you know, any number of the characters. Caesar. Ulysses, the courier.
Yeah, Ulysses would be an interesting one.
I think the courier as well would be a good one to run into.
Well, yeah, that was the one thing about the... just to go back to the Lonesome Road DLC, the fact that the courier just couldn't remember the shit that he did... You know, only a few years ago.
He was shot in the head, to be fair.
Well, yeah, but... No excuse in the video. How many times has he been shot in the head since that one?
Yeah, probably quite a lot.
Was that a magical bullet from Matthew Perry's gun?
Oh, Matthew Perry's terrible voice acting.
Yeah. I just love how they got him just because he admitted that Fallout 3 was his favourite game.
He's like, how about some Charlies for the big man? Hello.
Let's keep it smooth, like smooth little babies.
Oh god, just like it's, oh. that and Dinklage are the worst video game accidents I've ever seen. But yeah, like Avatar's TV series where like the setup is like you can have the Enclave and the Brotherhood and run-ins with the Railroad, and like you can introduce all those concepts to people who haven't played the games. It's just also a great way of introducing people into the games who haven't played it before. Mm. Have it be this long-running TV series and like have it end up with this guy falling into the darkness and being the villain of.
Well, that's the thing as well. If you're looking at the numbers from a sales point of view as well, if you have that being a successful TV series on its own,
yeah.
You end that with the final episode that's a massive eye-opener, you know, it ends with a bang and it sets itself up for something, and the only way you find out or the only way you live it is to then go to the game.
Yeah. You also, know, like, because of that 1950s Americana kind of art style in the future, like, it's so easy to market it, it's so easy to get people interested in it, it's so easy to create like cool looking props and effects, and like, and also the games, particularly the opening cutscenes, and also you can get Ron Perlman in to like narrate or be a character in that TV show.
He'd never do something to do with Fallout, would he?
You know, and like you could have, you know, there's a lot of cinematic shots. Like we were talking about my favorite one and your favorite one, which was like the pan out from the bus in the trailer.
Yeah,
that is the introduction to the TV series before you have the war never changes monologue.
Well, it's brilliant because, you know, the way the music transitions as well. It starts out as I Don't Want to Set the World on Fire.
Yeah.
And then just changes to the Fallout theme.
Well, the Fallout theme is brilliant.
And obviously in its most dark and sinister tone as well, out of the ways it's been done in different games, is a fantastic opener to Fallout and just saying, yeah, the world's a bit shit. Get used to it.
Yeah, exactly. And it's just, it's, I think it's like, yeah, we're long overdue in a Fallout TV series, and like the reason it's gotten so much traction and people are so interested in it is because it's, I mean, separate from whether or not you're a fan of the games, it's just a good concept for a TV show. And there's also been, there's a lot of interest right now in alternate history stuff anyway. Like we've had Man in the High Castle, SSGB, we've got more stuff coming out next year with like the Game of Thrones guys are doing the one about, you know, if the South had won the War of Independence. What we call the American Civil War, but would be called by them the War of Northern Aggression, or whatever it is. And like that's, you know, there's a lot of interest in that. And so having like, especially considering like, you know, alternate history becomes popular when people become dissatisfied with the world they live in. And if you're living in Trump's America, like
the people are going to want to harken back to the past.
Yeah, well, no, the scope for like the satire of having that very 1950s era McCarthy-esque kind of like, but in the future set America, where like the whole thing that went wrong with that world was the fact that America became so insular and so anti the rest of the world and isolationist and, you know, all of its worst qualities, you know, American exceptionalism. That's really interesting because that's essentially what we're getting now.
Yeah.
Like you could, thing is, and this is weird, like you can imagine Trump in the Fallout universe. You can imagine that President Trump being a president in the Fallout universe, or an equivalent, like that kind of.
My name is President John Henry Trump.
Yeah, but like, you know, like someone who's sort of like inadequately, you know, just not intelligent enough for the job, doesn't really know how to manage the country, everything's mismanaged, and it's all done on a kind of like a boastful image of America rather than the reality of a situation. Like, that's basically what went wrong in the Fallout universe, you know?
Yeah. We want to be the big tough one, so we're going to send nukes at you. Oh, fuck me, what's coming at us? Oh,
yeah, God. Like America refusing to share the loss of the oil in Fallout 4, sorry, in Fallout World, despite the fact they'd already had fusion power by that point and didn't need the oil anymore.
They still wanted it as a keepsake.
Yeah, they needlessly caused World War 3, basically. And like,
that doesn't sound like America.
it's very Trump-esque. Anyway, like, you know, not to criticize our American listeners. I mean, presumably most of you didn't vote Trump, and even the ones who did, I'm sure you know most people who voted Trump aren't assholes. They just hated the establishment, and you know, I can't really fault them for that. That's saved for a later debate.
But that'll be our one serious podcast out of the year.
But the point is, like, you know, the Fallout world is ideal for TV, essentially.
It's perfectly tailored, simply for the fact of, if you want to dumb it down, we live in volatile times at the moment.
Yeah.
And Fallout is just a play on volatile times gone to the worst case scenario.
Yeah, with wacky humour. Multiple
aggressors of different massive countries all firing shots at each other to prove whose dick's bigger than whose.
Not to mention the Fallout TV show would like give us some scope to explore some of the more like out there lore that the games can't focus on, like what happened to the rest of the world. You know, did China start the fight? Like who launched the first missile? You know, what was the things that we've only had reference, like the Yangtze campaign, like, you know, American power armor troops in mainland China,
the annexing of Canada.
Because we've heard, I mean, in the pit, they mentioned a guy being from Ronto, which is presumably Toronto in Canada. So, like, that's a thing, you know. that we can explore.
And it would make the games, especially even the older games, but the newer games to come as well, it would make all of them more wholesome.
Yeah.
You'd sit there, you'd have a greater depth and knowledge of the, obviously, especially if you're a hardcore fan, you watch everything. You'd have more knowledge of the entire world, and it would almost feel like you are in a world that's been situated around you, because you know what's happening in the game, but you know what's happening around other countries that aren't featured anywhere in the game. Yeah, but also, it's in that universe.
In this sort of fictional idea where we have Fallout 5 following on from TV series, when you get into Fallout 5, even though you're not the character you've been watching the TV show, you now know
about them,
the background of that world.
Yeah.
Before you get into it, and like, so if they want to carry on with like do a cold start of your character not being a vault dweller and just being a person in that world, you no longer have no reference point. Because the reason the vault characters worked better than the courier did was that like the vault characters were blank slates, like they had no more reason to know about the world than you did.
Yeah, whereas the courier had been living in that.
Yeah, well, the courier had been living in New Reno for like 26 years, and like they had to shoot him in the head so that he could be a blank slate. Yeah, I know, it is some nonsense. We can move on from that now, I think, and talk about some of the sillier fan theories that have come out, and actually just some of the more interesting fan theories in general that come around about Fallout. And so the first one, obviously, that we mentioned earlier in the podcast was Deacon. Is Deacon the lone wanderer?
Or is he just a cunt?
What do you think?
It's one of those ones you want to believe. You want to sit there.
Do you want the lone wanderer to be that knob?
Yeah.
No, Lone Wanderer in my head is way cooler than that guy is. I played as a Lone Wanderer. Deacon is not Lone Wanderer.
No, you want the Lone Wanderer to just be, everyone thinks he's that idiot, and then he rocks up with a fucking fat man and murks everyone, walks away with a dog.
I like the idea that Deacon is Puppet Man. That Deacon is Puppet Man would be a brilliant one. Or Grenade Man. Maybe Deacon's Grenade Man.
Ooh, actually, that would make sense. He is a troll.
He's a massive troll. But yeah, like Deacon, I like as a character for the most part. I just don't see him being the Lone Wanderer. I think the age is wrong for a start. I think he doesn't really fit a lot of the things. Also, he mentions Project Purity, and he mentions having been in the Capital Wasteland, which is obviously where a lot of people are like, oh, maybe he's the Lone Wanderer. But the thing is, he looks and sounds nothing like James. He's the wrong age. And also, he mentions having passed through it rather than having been from there. And there's a bunch of other things as well, like Madison Lee. If you walk around with him and Madison Lee, she doesn't recognise him.
Mm.
Which, you know,
having said that, there is also the theory behind, you know, Pinkerton in Fallout 3 and River City, where he had facial reconstruction, things like that. So you could almost give that a bit of leeway and say, yeah, he had his face fucked with.
Maybe Deacon is Harkness. That's about.
Well, there is the theory around if Deacon's not a lone wanderer, he could be a synth. So there might be some depth to that.
Yeah, again, I don't think he is a synth. I think if you kill him, he doesn't drop a synth component, so he's not actually a synth.
Maybe he's an advanced synth.
Dun, 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 dun.
Sorry, I've been watching Westworld.
Yeah, we've all been watching it recently, and I love it, so... Right, so the second fan theory is, the Enclave, are they actually evil, or are they secretly the good guys of Fallout? Because, as we've seen from Fallout 4, Fallout 3 goes to great lengths to paint the Brotherhood, the Capital Wasteland Brotherhood, as the good guys.
Mm.
But it is worth pointing out, the reason there's an outcast faction in Fallout 3 is because that Elder Leon's really took them in a radically different direction from the rest of the Brotherhood across the United States.
Mm.
And that the rest of Maxon is very much, you know, his xenophobic fanaticism in Fallout 4 is very much a return to form. And they even have a little thing, if you read his diary entries, you can see that he reintegrated the outcasts into the Brotherhood. So clearly, his brand of dickery is far more common in the Brotherhood than... And actually, Father Elijah's another example of that.
Yeah. And in fact, the father who followed after him as well wasn't exactly a shining example. He isolated them from everyone and caused a lockdown for years.
Yeah, they went into
years.
War with the NCR for essentially no reason.
Well, because they were trying to fight over a power plant, basically. Yeah. And just like, hey, let's waste half our guys because we kind of want a solar panel or two. But yeah, it seems like the Capital Wasteland Brotherhood was the good exception.
Since, particularly since the NCR would... as far as they knew, it was just a power plant, whereas the Brotherhood were well aware that it was the Archimedes weapon.
Yeah.
So, like, really, they wanted a weapon and the NCR just wanted some power.
Yeah. Who's the real bad guys there?
And, like, yeah, so the other idea is, like, you know, the Enclave aren't exactly great. You know, they are puritanical and semi-fascist. But, like, there's an argument that, like, they're far more like a pseudo-militaristic junta than they are, like, some kind of evil Nazi-ist kind of thing. That, like, they're weird and wrong. But they're not outright evil. They just have a very different idea of what they want for the Wasteland than like the Brotherhood. And actually, they're not too different from the Brotherhood. The Brotherhood are equally fanatical and anti-mutant and anti ghoul and stuff like that. And so really the only difference between them is that the Enclave is better equipped and has a more coherent idea of what they want out of a new world.
And there's less infighting.
Yeah, and there's less infighting. Whereas the Brotherhood is a far more splintered, Arthurian kind of... It's much more based on the myths and legends of Maxon rather than any coherent ideology.
Mm.
Hence the fact there's so many different interpretations of what they actually mean by collecting technology and safeguarding mankind and stuff like that.
No, they just want technology to be the gods.
Yeah.
Essentially.
Whereas on the Enclave, as evil as they are, they have a coherent vision for trying to rebuild America. So like...
Well, yeah, especially you see that quite a lot when you rebuild the remnants in Fallout New Vegas.
Yeah, they're not evil.
No.
They're just sick of all...
In fact, most of them hate Caesar's Legion because they...
They think they represent the dark ages of mankind rather than the technological future.
Apart from the one guy, but I shot him in the face.
Yeah. And the Institute sort of the same thing as well. Like, the Institute, they get criticised for what they're doing. But, like, apart from enslaving the synths, which is obviously a bit of a no-no, and a big no-no, but, like, they're trying to resurrect civilization, and they are the most technologically advanced. And they're not... You meet Father, and you meet the scientists, and, like, they're arrogant and cold and remote and distanced from the people of the Commonwealth. They're not actually actively trying to be dicks.
No, they're just those people that aren't exactly nice people, but that doesn't mean their intentions are completely hostile to everything.
That's what happens when you have scientists with good intentions and no oversight, essentially.
Yeah.
And I think that's, like, obviously that's the message. It's like the Brotherhood against science gone wild, and the Institute is science gone wild. But simultaneously, the Institute probably think of the Brotherhood as, you know, fanatically repressed idiots, like, the like of which caused the war in the first place. So they've both got valid points about each other, and like the same is true of all the factions. Like the Railroad have issues, the Minutemen have issues. I don't even know what the Gardeners are doing; they're just assholes.
yeah, we'll leave them to one side for a bit.
Yeah, exactly. And like, yeah, I mean, it's far from clear cut. Like, doesn't Ulysses wear an old world flag on his back?
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
Enclave style.
Yeah, and so the Enclave are. Far from concretely evil. Like, they're not evil.
Having said that, you could also say that Ulysses sided with Caesar's Legion for a bit.
True. He was a Frumentarius.
And he was also with the White Legs.
Yeah,
in Zion.
But, like, the thing is, like, the Enclave aren't outright evil in the way that the Master from Fallout 2 was.
Oh, God.
He was just, like, an outright dick who wanted to take over...
A sad little flap.
I realised we missed off on one of my great characters from our favourite characters. Harold. Harold's amazing. Anyway.
I call him Bob. It's not his name, but it annoys him.
I just love how he's become a running gag now in Fallout. Like, he's just there now.
Yeah. He's immortalized.
Okay, so the other big fan theory, which is sort of born out of Mothership Zeta. Did aliens cause the war? There is evidence. And also, there's a cut bit of dialogue. Was it cut accidentally? Like, you can access the audio log, but if you listen to it in the game, all you hear is nothing.
Mm.
But if you actually read the transcript and the code... It's them torturing a pre-war guy for nuclear missile launch codes.
Mm.
So, like, there is some evidence that they started the war.
And they also have, when you're on Mothership Zeta, you can be that kind of asshole that aims the death ray at Earth and fires it.
Yeah, which means some poor bastard in Africa just got obliterated.
Yeah. But, so obviously they have the means to destroy quite a large area of Earth very quickly. Especially if they're... They might not be wholly responsible for it. It could be a joint effort across all parties. They might have just seen people firing missiles and thought, hey, I'll take pot shots and join in.
Okay, and then like our final, before we get on to Fallout 5, our final fan theory was the born out of MacCready in Fallout 4, who his mission essentially is about the fact that his son has a disease with horrible symptoms that seems to be incurable, and he's dying from it. And what's interesting is the description of the symptoms that he gives is identical to the description of the symptoms of people who suffered from the new plague before the war started, which MedTech had to solve, which caused a huge crisis in America even before the war began, and even before the oil crisis. And so, and obviously, which FEV was originally the Pan Immunity Viron project.
Yeah.
Pan Viral Immunity project or something like that. But like, yeah, it was born out of that. And so. Someone's posited the theory that because, you know, we've now 200 plus years after the world ended and we've got nation states like the NCR, it might be being a bit too civilized now for a Fallout game. So maybe we need another world ending event to sort of bring us back to a kind of wasteland-esque kind of position, which is the new plague again.
Fallout 5, run back to the capital wasteland and find the FEV that the lone wanderer chucked away.
Yeah, exactly. which is, again, like, I mean, like, that's not one we can really discuss, and, like, there's no evidence really for it one way or the other. It's just a fan theory. But it's interesting in that, like, that is... Can you see them doing that? Can you see Bethesda just sort of, like, nuking everyone again with... I mean, literally, metaphorically, rather, like, with a renewed disease?
Well, yeah, because, you know, with each passing game, X amount of time has passed. With something like that, you would expect the Wasteland to become more civilized, the Wasteland to keep getting better, and eventually for the Earth itself to start healing. Obviously, there's the theory that we both like, in the fact of it's still a Wasteland because people won't stop fucking shooting stuff.
The nuclear cars are the reason we haven't had like a reset environmentally yet.
Which, I quite like that. You know, why hasn't the planet healed? Some asshole runs around with a fat man.
Some asshole Deacon.
Who's looking at you?
He's looking at you, Deacon, you tool.
But you can definitely see why they would have to do something like that. Because if it gets too civilized, you're basically going to play an entire game of Fallout, but pre-war.
Yeah.
Or post-war, even.
Okay, and so to wrap up our podcast, we're going to spend the last 10 minutes just talking about Fallout 5. And so before we get onto what we want from Fallout 5, I'm going to run through some of the fan theories, and you can tell me what you think about them, you know, for possible settings. The big one... Based on the fact that when you're investigating Kellogg's memories in the memory den in Fallout 4, you hear and lots of characters refer to it anyway, you get a lot of San Francisco references. And San Francisco was the setting, obviously, for Fallout 1, if I'm not mistaken. Mm. And it's already got a very well-written culture, and we've already got a lot of reference to it, and like we know what's there vaguely, and like it's very easy for the game developers, and also it's an iconic city, it's very easy for the game developers to turn around and be like, cool, that's... And if I'm going to be honest, I think it will be there. I think that's probably where it will be.
Most likely, at least. Most exciting, definitely not.
But that was the big leading theory so far for Fallout 5. Do you think that's going to be the case? Do you think that it will be San Fran?
Well, definitely. They like leaving hints towards things, especially they started when they were doing the DLC phase for Fallout New Vegas, they started playing around with just dropping hints for each forthcoming DLC, and yeah. They've sort of expanded on that.
And Fallout 3 Fallout dropped 4. Boston's name quite hard.
Yeah. Yeah, with the Commonwealth.
Yeah.
So they love leaving little hints towards things like that. And to be honest, I don't see them breaking the trend yet.
The counter on that, I suppose, is like, that's not a hint so much as a slam in your face. Like, look, it's San Fran. Here's the Golden Gate Bridge and the memories. So it could just be them making a callback to Fallout 1 and the fact that, you know, remember this, guys.
Mm. Fallout 1 remaster confirmed.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Like, the argument again is like, it'll be nice to see, it'll be interesting to see that in a Fallout, in a 3D open world setting.
Mm.
Whether or not it'd be interesting from a lore perspective is perhaps different, because we've already spent time there. We already know what's there.
Yeah.
We've already explored the vaults in that area in another game.
Mm.
There's not really much more we can do unless they just rewrite the first game as not having happened, which they can't do because they've referenced it, you know.
Yeah.
There's not really much we can do there other than just seeing how decisions have panned out for everyone. Yeah. We know the Shi'ar still there because Kellogg mentions them. Although that being said, Kellogg's like over 100 years old, so presumably he could have been there at the time that the first... Vault Dweller was running around.
Or he could have Alzheimer's.
Or Kellogg could be the Vault Dweller. There's a new fan theory for you. So the second one that was mentioned is built off like Point Lookout and that kind of swampy kind of area was Fallout New Orleans. I'm going to be honest, I'm not keen on this. I like the swamp setting. I think over an entire game it would get old very quickly.
Yeah, you want the marshland as a new area to explore, but As
DLC, Fallout New Orleans as DLC, I would love.
The only thing you could do anything like that is if the swamp was suddenly, you know, swamps that opened into these swampy lakes, things like that, and you could go underwater, you could explore.
Because I know you want a DLC or like your Fallout game is Snowbound.
Yeah, so...
It's like Fallout Minnesota or Fallout Alaska or something.
Yeah,
or,
so...
Or if we go to Canada, Fallout Toronto.
Mm, Fallout Toronto would be quite a nice one.
That would be good.
Fallout Scotland.
Fallout Norway.
Hey, come here, you wee cunt.
Fallout Iceland. Fallout Shetland Islands.
Nothing happened, the end.
Yeah, literally, a fish flops onto the floor, like, oh dear, the end.
I paid 50 quid for this.
I don't think there's much to say about the New Orleans setting, other than, like, it would be very similar, I guess, to Point Lookout and Far Harbor and that kind
It'd
of thing.
It'd be Point Lookout dragged out and killed.
If they want to really hammer the Lovecraft stuff, it's a good place to go, which is why I think it works better for DLC, because I don't think there's enough there to sustain it over an entire game.
Well, yeah, if you're going to sustain it over an entire game, you're just ripping off Lovecraft. It's, you know, there's a fine line between referencing and stealing.
And stealing, yeah. I agree with that. There is, obviously, Toronto, we've mentioned. Mm. As a possible one, because it's mentioned again in the pit, as it's called Ronto, it does exist.
Mm.
New Reno, we got a lot of references to in New Vegas, but again, I feel like we spent enough time there in Fallout 1 and 2.
Yeah.
That's a possibility. An interesting one, which hasn't been mentioned, which I think would be potentially quite interesting, because I know Bethesda's like that area, would be Fallout Seattle.
Maybe.
And that would allow you to do your winter setting as well, because Washington State is fucking freezing.
Yeah, true.
And rainy as hell. And it'd just be it would be a return to the kind of grimness of Fallout 3, I guess, as well, with that kind of setting. My concern is Seattle an interesting enough area other than the city itself to really have anything there? There's like, are there any air bases there? Are there any like cool monuments there? Not really. There's not.
Unless you want to claim that it's a city hidden under a city, but that sounds like a lot of work for BS explaining.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's, if you want to do that, just pick a city with a metro system.
Yeah.
There's Fallout New York.
What, like DC?
Well, Fallout New York's been mentioned.
Yeah, Fallout New York. That seems like it'd be a bit of a rip-off of one of the Crisis games, though.
Or Metro.
Yeah.
So, which was Fallout. Essentially Fallout.
I love the idea of very claustrophobic, close quarters fighting on, you know, overcrowded city blocks, completely in ruins. Mm. But again, over the course of a game, you want it to be a mix of both. You want to have those close quarters areas, but you want to have the roaming aspect as well.
Yeah, I agree.
The one thing I would say would be quite good is, like, in New York, would be the vertical aspect, as in going up in the buildings.
Skyscrapers and, like, platforming between skyscrapers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
If they did that, would be interesting. And also the Statue of Liberty might be an interesting one to go through. Having, like, a settlement built out the inside of the statue would be interesting. Although I don't know how easily the Statue of Liberty is going to survive a nuke. Yeah, I don't know. It would be bold. I'm not sure I'd like it very much. I think I'd have to do it very precisely right to get away with that.
I know which one we're building up to, which is your favourite one, which also, since you mentioned it, keeps growing on me as well. So if you want to lay that one down.
That final one, which is my original idea, which I don't think has been mentioned anywhere else, which was Fallout Hawaii. Because I like it for various reasons. I like it because if you want to carry on with that factional, you know, the battle between factions, and also if you want to expand on the settlement build, which was sort of left at a loose end in Fallout 4, having the idea of an expanded, like, you know, jumping between the islands, or having settlements on different islands in Hawaii, and then battling for control over Hawaii as a whole, and stuff like that, is a great idea, and, like, you know, conquering new territories. Because again, also, there is Fallout lore which feeds into that, so there is some Fallout lore about Hawaii, which is the Crystal Coast, which is the name of a settlement, the biggest settlement, or second biggest settlement in Hawaii, in the new, I think it's the Republic of New Waikiki or something, which is the sort of successor state there. And New Waikiki occupies the main, half of the main island of Hawaii, which I can't remember the name off the top of my head. You know, that's the main faction. That could be like your NCR almost, and like you could have like an enclave remnants base in Hawaii, or you could have the Poseidon oil rig offshore from Fallout 1 and 2 as a bit of DLC, or just offshore. There's lots of scope to play with. It's a very different environment because it's, you know,
sandy beaches, which have gone complete fuck up.
It's like tropical beach, post-apocalyptic nuclear tropical beaches.
The scope for new creatures, new enemies as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Would just be like, fantastic.
As a break with the thing with what's come before, whilst keeping that Fallout vibe and that Americana vibe. Also, it's an aspect of the Americana we haven't yet seen. In that 1950s Hawaiian Americana was huge, like Elvis and stuff like that. And we haven't really seen that yet in this Americana-driven universe.
Well, I mean, I suppose you call it a very far-fetched teaser for it, but in Fallout 4 they have the enemies, the giant hermits.
Yeah, no, that's true.
That's totally them.
Also, because Hawaii is a volcanic landscape. You can have lava as well, like volcanic areas. And like,
lava in Fallout, that would be good.
Yeah, exactly. Radiation storms over lava pits.
Well, especially because it's set so far in the future as well. There would be a lot of things around lava, you know, geothermal energy, things like power stations set up around volcanic areas.
Yeah. Poseidon energy could have a large foothold on the island, you know.
You know,
maybe China used it as a like, you know, as like they were planning to do in World War II, invaded Hawaii as a stepping stone to invade Alaska.
Yeah,
and there could be a Chinese presence.
So it
could
be the middle ground. You could see, you know,
remnants of the battles there.
Like, yeah, giant US areas, almost like the Somme.
Yeah, the US having reclaimed like areas from the Chinese, like burnt out power armor, the front, like having see some of the front lines of that warfare, like, you know, abandoned propaganda posters and abandoned military bases and stuff like that.
Yeah,
there are a lot of military bases, like in Hawaii. Obviously, Hawaii plays host to one of the biggest naval bases, which is Pearl Harbor in America.
I'm just going to take a second pounding.
There's plenty of monuments as well with Pearl Harbor. There's the USS is it Indianapolis, the one that's there?
I believe so.
Yeah, and like the, you know,
I'll trust you on that.
It's the big battle ship that's moored there permanently as a tourist attraction. You can have a bit more references to Britain and exploration because obviously Captain Cook went there. The Hawaiian flag has a Union Jack on it.
So far, the only link to Britain we have is Alistair Tenpenny.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see some of the like Filipino, Hawaiian Americans. You know, like just non-white Native Americans. Not Native Americans as in Indians, but
we could also, and that's scope for different kinds of super mutants, different kinds of ghouls. Some, you know, something like different
some bleached albino ghoul.
Ooh,
something like that.
Glows in daylight.
You know, maybe expand it so we can have enemies in the water. Like we sort of did that in Fallout 4 with some of the fish, but like.
It's been in every Bethesda game, that's always been something that they never really do. There's always about one enemy that can kind of swim a little bit and goes for you if you're in the water, but there's never been anything, you know, radioactive rainbow shark.
Particularly if they take on that idea of having, like, you build up settlements and as build up your nation as well, like, build up your community, like, the conquering of the islands. Mm. Right? Each island has, like, a different kind of, like, type of society on it, or, like, different raider groups, or, like, a kind of.
Yeah, so what would work for running Far Cry one island? Three style
pirate
for...
islands, you know, with a, what's it called in Fallout 3?
Hoyt and Vast?
Vast, yeah, like, have a Vast-esque villain. And then, and obviously we mentioned this earlier, the Lone Wanderer.
Shows up out of fucking nowhere.
Could be like, you know, have these factions on each island battling it out, but have like some kind of like mysterious villain behind it all who's tipping the scales. Manipulating everything in his own favour, and have that turn out to be the Lone Wanderer, who's sort of gone a bit mad and is trying to reclaim civilization, like trying to live up to his dad's legacy of Project Purity by trying to rebuild Hawaii as a kind of like civilized place, and is doing so in a way that's very nuts and evil and sort of enclave-ish.
Mm. But with completely good intentions, just warped by the brutality of war.
Or just any of the previous like protagonists. I mean, maybe not Soul Survivor, because I don't think he'd be there, but like...
Yeah, he's a bit of a dud anyway.
But like, the Courier?
The Courier could be.
Courier could pop up?
I mean, I'd love to see a throwdown between the Lone Wanderer and the Courier, but the Lone Wanderer would stomp him. Rip his ass off and hand it to him within 5 seconds.
But like, yeah, just things like that. I think Hawaii... Of all the places, like I said, it has the most scope for change while simultaneously keeping what's the best things that we have about Fallout now and expand. And also, just because of the nature of the geography there, expanding on the features they were trying to introduce in Fallout 4 in a more meaningful way.
And speaking of features they were trying to introduce in Fallout 4, one thing they can add with Hawaii, colour. Finally.
Colour that makes sense.
Yes.
Whilst also having scope, like if you have lava areas, something like the more grim kind of like Fallout.
Yeah, you could have this kind of... dusty.
Also with the lava, you could like sort of recreate that necropolis feel, having like a ghoul community based out in the badlands of a lava wasteland or something.
Yeah, you could have some very horrifying things where the lava is your only light to find your way through a cave, things like that.
Underground cave systems.
Exactly.
I don't know if there's a metro system in Hawaii. There might be.
There is now.
If not, it's Fallout. You could bullshit, say that they built one in the meantime.
Well, you could just say that they're secret, you know, like the presidential metro that you got in Broken Steel. You could say there was something like that for high-class military executive.
Yeah, something like that.
You can BS your way around little things like that. No one's going to shoot you down.
That also happens to slightly Bioshock it. If you had, like, like train systems that go run between the islands and, like, they have, like, glass walls, you can slightly Bioshock that. Which would be a great way to mix those kind of genres, because again, Bioshock is it's almost like the spiritual cousin to Fallout in a way.
It is, yeah, and a mixer between those two would probably get everyone talking and moist.
Yeah, and so Bethesda, that's our final word. Fallout 5, make it Hawaii, give it to me, allow me to direct the TV series. Geordi can run around being a ghoul. He's already kind of done it for our Fallout short film.
Shameless self-advertising. Shameless,
yeah. Look at Hominid on the Outcast website.
Who did that?
I don't know, some genius.
I know, right?
Some unmitigated genius.
You know, there was this guy dressed up as a mole, but even through that you could tell
his beauty, his inner beauty.
Radiating
sex appeal.
Through that suffocating postiche.
So yeah, we're going to end it there. For me and Geordi, hearty goodbye. Thank you for listening. Our next podcast. Thank you for surviving. Because, you know, podcasts never change.
Or do they?
Or do they? The podcast has changed. Next time we will be talking about James Bond, specifically the many STIs of James Bond. No, we'll be talking about James Bond, fan theories about James Bond, who our favourite Bond is, and who we'd like to see as the next James Bond. But we don't want to just hear our own thoughts, as beautiful and well-crafted as they are. We want to hear yours. So leave in the comments your favourite bits of Fallout, what you'd like to see in a future Fallout game. You know, any random thing you'd like to see in Fallout. Would you want Fisto to make a return? I want Fisto to make a return. I think Fisto wants to return. He can be the villain of Fallout 5. What do you think of that?
And as one final bonus, if you want to put down in the comments, on a scale of 1 to 10, how loud does James Bond scream when he pees?
And remember to answer our question about who you think is who, voice-wise. Because I'm intrigued. Yeah, so from all of us here at Zero Fox Given, goodbye, farewell, so long, stay sexy, and we will see you next time.
Another sexy with me.